government role, I worked with Sapient. I was director of technology with Sapient. After Sapient, I chose to get into a model where I can help potentially more companies and more projects than I was handling in Sapient. That's when I joined Emergent. My engagement with Emergent goes back to about 2009, when I ran my third large transformation for Vodafone in Newbury, UK, which is from a pure waterfall-driven organization to a complete agile-driven organization. At the end of that transformation, we kind of presented back to the boards and the shareholders, and Vodafone Telecom, from that point, reverted back from position of number 9 to number 3. And that's when we, as an Emergent, started producing this product, which I'm going to give you an insight today, which is called Value Flow Quality. I have a few slides to rush through, but we do have a break after this. So if you have questions, I can take it during the session, but I can definitely take it after the session. So I start with this quotation, which is from T. Hawk. And this is exactly where I feel where most of our waterfall agile implementations currently stand. I thought and I expected that agile came in, and then I got involved in agile about 9 years back, that this will take away the bureaucracy and the mediocrity of complex processes away, but I don't think we have. I've been doing standups for 9 years now. I've been doing standups in Sapient when I think Scrum did not even become popular. But I think at this point in time, when we do stand-ups, right, it's more like going through the turn of the morning. People do come up, people do stand up in front of the whiteboard, and they clamor in terms of what they're planning to achieve today. But the business value still gets delivered to the client much later. We still have a quality which is fairly bad. And we still have captives in India, most captives in India, doing reorganization, three of which I'm part of. So there is something which we haven't done very right. There is something in the agile implementations. There is something in our waterfall implementation, we haven't done it right. This is one of my favorite quotes, and I do believe simple, clear principles does lead to intelligent behavior. And we are right now burying whole projects under a whole set of practices, whole set of metrics, which we don't need. And we need to figure out a way to come out of it. My next 45 minutes, I will try to give you 3 basic principles and 6 basic patterns which I have seen in my 20 years, which Emergent has seen in their career of about 11 years, and some of us who have worked with consultants from a lot of specialized organizations have come together and believe that if you have these 3 principles and these 6 patterns in your organization, for all you care, you are agile. You don't follow DAG, you don't follow SAFe, you don't follow Scrum, you don't follow Kanban, you may not even know what Lean is, but if you know these 3 principles and 6 patterns, you are agile. Go celebrate. Could we improve the way we deliver projects? I just gave you my experience. What is your experience? Could you deliver the projects you are part of currently? So usually the answer is yes. And usually the answer is we want to become more faster. We want to become more responsive. We want to become less risky. We want to become more efficient. In 1995, the Standish report, most of my pre-sales when I ran in Sapient, right? I ran pre-sales for about 8 or 10 years and won a lot of projects. This was one of my favorite things, which I used to bring it up in every single project, which I used to go and sell. Because in Sapient, I used to go back and say, you know what? We have done better than this. Do you have any guesses in terms of how many projects failed in 1995, IT projects? 60. 55%. 33% is the number. 33% number is the number for the project which outrightly failed. It yet doesn't talk about projects which delivered bad outcomes, which delivered outcomes spending much more money than the value which the project brought to the company. This talks about only that project outrightly failed. How many projects would you think costed more than the value they delivered?
80%.
80% of the IT projects which we delivered incurred more costs than the value they delivered. And we would have improved, right? From 1995 to 2015, you would expect that we would have improved. In 2011, another similar statistics, and this data is not only PM Solutions, by the way, you have 3 more reports from 2011. You can go back and take a look from Gartner, from PM Solutions, there's one more which I'm forgetting the name of. Almost all of them indicate about 40% of the projects in IT still continue to fail.
And this is on a much, much larger base.
Yeah, this is a base which is, Gartner base was the smallest, it's about 3,000 projects they kind of interviewed, but VM solution base was fairly large. And the third report is even larger. So 35% of the projects failed in 2005, 37% failed in 2011. So we are, which is, we are getting worse. We are attending agile conferences, we are saying, hey, you know Scrum, you know Kanban, you know Lean, but we are getting worse in terms of delivering value, business value to our clients. How many of you work for captives in this room? When I say captive, okay, one. Anybody else?
Can you say
one? What I meant captives was basically an extension center or extension arm of a company which is based outside, which delivers solutions for their own company, not for somebody else. So like banking organizations, Cisco, Vodafone, they're all captive for me.
RPS.
Cool. Most captives at this point of time are going through a restructuring. Any captive which has spent 6 to 8 years in India at this point of time is completely overhauling the way they work. And there is a reason for that. And the reason is this. People haven't seen the value. And I will extend that to say India hasn't delivered the value. And I'm sorry for that. Delivery are late again, project is over budget, they only ever have problems or solutions. The last estimate was out by a factor of 10. The first project which I saw in SAPIT was out by a factor of 14. By a factor of
14.
14 days. 14 times.
That was in which year?
That was 2004. That was 14. I was out here. Perhaps how we have been delivering what is flawed. There is an author whose name is Dan Weinerston. If you haven't read his book called Product Development Flow, my earnest request to all the IT people in this room would be buy this book today if you can. And it will be a difficult read. You will not get it in the first go, but read it 3 times and you get it. It's almost the software engineering principles specimen book we all read in our software engineering. It's as fundamental to IT today as that software specimen principles were. That's what Don Weinerston says about product development. He says the dominant paradigm of managing product development is wrong. And it's not only wrong, it's wrong to its very core.
What's the name of the book?
Product Development Flow by Don Weinerston. Yeah. And why is this? How could so many people be wrong, right? We have had fairly intelligent people running IT industry. We have had fairly big stalwarts who have been moved into IT industry from fairly large industries. And I guess we have all of us in the room who would, most of us would claim that we are really fairly sharp, intelligent, experienced people, right?
I think it's because of a lot of these is borrowed from workshop based modeling and manufacturing.
So maybe we just haven't been doing this long enough, right? Some of the people say that any industry to mature takes about 100 years. And we are just about 50 to 60 years into the industry. That might be the reason why we are not as predictable. So the gentleman here was fairly close, right? He said that. Basically, we pinched our ideas from somewhere else. If you have a sibling at home, you know, the only thing which you know when you're being brought up in your family, which has an elder sibling, is you ape him. That's the only thing you know to do. I have two daughters, and my younger daughter continues to completely ape my elder one. He doesn't do anything differently. And we did exactly the same. We pinched our ideas from an industry called manufacturing. We ran after Henry Ford. He was the most successful people around us. And that's what we believed. That if he's doing it right this way, that has to be right. Of course, there are similarities, right? There are similarities. Both have got a process, both want to be efficient, and both have large quantities of work being produced. So there were similarities, yes, to start with, but they are fundamentally different. Anybody who was in the Bangalore Agile Conference 2 months back? Anybody who has heard of a person called David Snowden? So David Snowden is a person who gave a model, and I will go through these 6 slides in a second. But he gave us a model which called that all systems in this world are of 4 types. He said on the simplest scale, you have a system which is absolutely simplistic, or which he calls as Bayes system or simplistic system. And he says, on the other end of the spectrum, you have a system which is chaotic. A simplistic system has a very basic relationship between cause and effect. If you touch a hot plate, you will get burned. You will never touch a hot plate again. You've just, you know, evolved a very simplistic system in David Stone's world. If you are in a completely chaotic world, which is basically, if you're driven in Indian traffic, that's an example of a chaotic world, there's no relationship between cause and effect. Or even if there is one, it's almost impossible to figure out what is that relationship. And that's why it's very difficult to control it. Population is a chaotic system. It's impacted by so many things, it's very difficult to control. Otherwise, a lot of countries would have done something about it by now. Between simple and chaotic systems lie two kinds of systems. One is called complicated, one is called complex. In a complicated system, there is a relationship between cause and effect. It's further apart, but there is a relationship. If your car goes bad, you know how to fix the car by taking it to a mechanic. So a specialist person can figure out what the relationship between cause and effect is and do something about it. That are called complicated systems. Manufacturing is a complicated system. IT falls into the category of complex system. Please do Google on Sinophin model if you have some free time in the next 1 week and read up on this. A complex system, the cause and effect are related, but effect impacts the cause as much as cause impacts the effect. And the only way to work in a complex model, which Sinophin proves, which David Snowden proves as part of Sinophin model, is through probe, sense, and respond. The only mechanism by which you can manage a complex system is to do something about it, sense the results, and then do something about it again. So this is how the complicated and complex systems compare, right? Productive output is also, production output is repetitive, production output is unique. Largely the software which you produce, the code which you write, the developer, when he writes a Java class, or when he writes a JavaScript method, that is unique. If it was written before, he would have done a copy-paste anyways. It's unique. Most of the work which you do is unique. Production work is predictable, software work is largely unpredictable. On a conveyor belt, if a car rolls in from end one and car rolls out from the end two, that same conveyor belt will run year after year till I put a new vehicle in. That's not how it works in software. We almost every single release or sprint which we run, the output is very different. It's not repetitive. Production requirements are fixed, development requirements evolve. We are dealing with human beings on the second part. We are dealing with human beings whose thinking changes. The more innovative the idea is, more it is likely to change. And if we are trying to control it by repetitive controlling methods like what we had in manufacturing, we will fail. We can't control it that way. And we will try to manage a system which is not repetitive through manufacturing methods. Production work is bounded, development work is largely unbounded. Production inventory is visible. This is another key thing. Very subtle, but very key thing. If you have read about Kanban, you might have heard about it. The Kanban came into existence because there was a person in Toyota which said, I will not order more inventory till I have used up what I have. He could do it because he could see inventory piling up in front of him. In software, you cannot see inventory piling up in front of you. It is a line of byte code inside a machine. So you can't see it. You can't see what a developer has written 500 lines of code extra than what we really need. Then how would you take control it? So a complicated system is repetitive, predictable, fixed, bounded, and visible. And a complex system is unique, unpredictable, evolving, unbounded, and invisible. I just took you through a very theoretical underpinning behind software and non-software systems because I want to bring you down to something which is this. Anybody in the room who has not seen this iron triangle before? Or doesn't know what is iron triangle is. And raise your hand if you don't. I will spend 2 minutes explaining. Cool. So most of the IT companies are project managed by project managers who have been virtually given in their kit feed this iron triangle that manage your projects by cost, time, and scope. These are the three parameters by which you manage projects. If you have these three aspects of project state control, you will have the project. And all of us who have played PM's role in our lives in the past have used these three parameters. I have to manage the cost through which the project is run. I have to make sure it gets delivered on time. And I have to make sure that the scope which I'm signing up for gets delivered on that specific date. If I'm managing these three parameters well, I will be rated as a good employee of my IT organization. I'll be rated 5 out of 5, and I will get equivalents. This Allen triangle came from in practice. And this is an oversimplification of the problem we are trying to solve in IT. There's a game which I usually play when I run some of these sessions with my clients, where I make guys make this boat. I gave them some papers and asked them to make this boat. And then before they make the boat, I ask them, give me the estimate on which at which you will deliver this boat. Yeah, I'm kind of spilling off the secret with you, but I'll do that anyways. And usually people come back and say, I will take 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 8 minutes. Usually people get done with the board in like 1.5 minutes or 2 minutes. What do they do after that? They spend 3 minutes decorating the board with sketch pens. They do, yeah. Sometimes they do that as well. But even if you're done early, right, people spend the time which they have committed. That is what delivery on time does it, right? If you go to a developer and say, guys, tell me exactly when you deliver it, he will tell you 3 months. And I will make sure I take 3 months. One of my first initial projects as a software engineer in USA, right, I had a database script to write. And I remember I gave to my boss an estimate of 3 months. And I went back and delivered that estimate in 1.5 months. I was beaten up for it. Yeah.
How much time have you seen this situation? There are two consequences or two aspects. One is trying to fill the buffer and time you have, and the other is actually not being able to do that and trying to do it harder and harder so that we fit in within the timeline.
Both. I've seen both. And I think the point which I'm trying to make is not really whether you have missed whether you've delivered early or later. The point which I'm trying to make is trying to manage your projects by delivering on time, the one vertex of the Allen triangle which we saw, is fundamentally flawed. Either I have underestimated and I'll fill up the time, or I'll overestimate and fill up the time, or I'll underestimate and then bleed. And then you have burnouts, and people will quit and leave the organization and keep running between 6 organizations in IT we have.
They seem to keep all the 3 things fixed.
Just manage the project by managing these 3 parameters, yes. Anyways, so what happens when you're trying to manage on time, right? Let's just talk about that. When you're trying to manage a project on time, you are filling up the extra time with buffers. Or you are saying, he's my boss and he's asking me the time when I'm done with it. I will as well fill it with buffers. All of us have added buffers. I have as a developer. I have as a project manager. I have as a senior project manager. I have as a director. I have as a sponsor as well, by the way. And never ever have I gone back and given that time back to somebody who gave it to me. Did I ever? No, never. I don't remember if anybody ever did it. Because we are looking for predictability in our project plans. WhatsApp is not looking for predictability. Facebook is not looking for predictability. They are too entrepreneurial and too free in their heads to come into existence with 17 people and hash something out because they don't even know what they will deliver in 17 days. We had a Tesco guy in the morning in the room. I don't know whether Sekhar is still there, but if he's around, said Tesco is right now losing to companies like Little. Little is a small kirana shop in Indian parlance. Tesco is a multi-billion dollar organization and they're losing out. They just registered 6.5 billion losses 3 months back. Because Little has no axe to grind. They have no, basically, firm rules or processes again to comply to. So they're too fast. A Christmas offer, if it takes 17 days to hit up, to hit the shelves of Tesco, it takes about 3.5 days to hit the shelves of Little. Who will win? Little will win, and they're winning. If we continue to manage projects by time, and if we continue to make our teams predictable, I kid you not, India is going to lose all of its business to somebody else. Because there are people waiting out there. I do product development as I do agile coaching, and I see, I give my work on Odesk to people in India, I give my work on Odesk to people in Poland, and I give my work on Odesk to people in Russia. People who are coming from SI organizations continue to buffer in India. I have a Polish guy who hacks out the code in 1.5 days. If I had time, I would have shown you the logistics application we are currently working on. That guy has hacked out the code in 1.5 days, for which I have still an offer of 1.5 months or 2 months from a company in Chandigarh. This is just an issue at a very small scale. This is exactly the issue utilities are facing. This is the exact issue Tesco's are facing.
What do you think SIs in India are still behaving
differently? I'll come to that in a second. Managing the project by cost, we all add contingencies. Just like we add buffer to our efforts, we add contingencies to our costs. And we turn out to be much more expensive in our cost to our end clients, whether they are captives and the clients are sitting across the geography in US or UK, or whether it's actually end clients sitting somewhere else. We are always expensive because we're adding contingencies to our cost. Because we want to manage it, right? We want to control it. Third, scope. If I give you one option or one opportunity to define a scope, right, you will throw everything into it. Because you don't even know whether I'm going to come back to you and ask you, do you need anything else? If you know I'm going to come back and ask you, do you need anything else, multiple times during my execution of a project, I will not throw everything into it. But if you give me only one option to do that, and if you sign up a big contract between Infosys and XYZ, I almost believe strongly, right, the end client is going to throw everything into it, because that's his lever to negotiate and kind of beat you up later. So in a way, this iron triangle is what we need to break out of. If you haven't been taught in the iron triangle management of projects, good for you. Don't learn it, please. And if you have, please unlearn that. It's a very difficult thing to unlearn. And I'm finding, I'll just finish this and I'll take a question. I'm finding it very, very difficult with senior project managers and directors to unlearn this. They are the most difficult people in my sessions. They're the most painful people. But they have the experience as well, by the way. They are the ones who can bail us out, except if they break this iron triangle. I take a question.
I was just saying, why is this happening?
I'll give you part of the answer, and part of the answer we can talk about offline once we have a break. In a lot of Indian organizations, we are looking for predictability.
Because this is not Indian problem.
I'm right now talking largely in context of Indian captives and Indian SIs, and that was one of my objectives of this, but I agree it's not only an Indian problem. And the issue is, as soon as we grow bigger, right, we want to manage something, and to manage something, you manage with something which what you have. And if you continue to do this, this is the point which I make, and then you come back to your question. We need to change what we focus on. If you continue to focus on wrong parameters, you'll continue to get wrong results.
Exactly. So that's what my point is. I think this whole phenomenon is coming back from the same industrial revolution,
yes,
where things are predictable. You know, when you look at the chain in the production house where car parts are being created, the behavior is predictable.
Yeah.
There are machines who will produce at a certain rate, and loss of predictability is very, very heavy. There's a very high dependence between how you assemble parts. So if there's no predictability between two machine generation systems, the whole plant will go for a toss.
I agree with you.
And that's how this whole philosophy evolved, that everybody wants to be predictable. But then, as you said, it's apples and oranges. We are applying same principles in the two places, which are very, very different inherently.
This is the weapon which was given to us. And I think some of us have questioned it, some of us have not questioned it. People who have realistically questioned it, there are large organizations who are still doing very, very well. Some organizations which I love is Netflix. Right? Some of these organizations have done this. Google still is managing to do it somehow. It's a very large organization. It's still managing to do it. So you need to start from our first principles, which is not really coming from manufacturing guys. Anyways, so I'll come back to this point multiple times in the next 15 minutes. But anyways, so we need basically new rules of thumb. Emergent has made its own attempt to replace these three rules of thumb. I am standing behind that slide deck currently because I believe that rules of thumb work for me. It may or may not work for you, but I think it's worth a try because it kind of falls in place for me theoretically. And when I try to apply it across three large clients, that will work for me. I'll take you to the first one. You need to replace the concept of cost in your head by concept of value. Replace managing a project by cost by delivering value early and often. It's as simple as that. Our product backlogs, how many in this room have a product backlog which has got a business value populated? 2, 3, 4. Very large percentage for even the 20 people in the room. 25%? Not even that. Nobody, almost no organization, whether it claims to be agile or whether it's saying I'm running an agile journey, has a business value property in their brand platforms. They have no sense of how much value I'm delivering. You're not agile. Meetings, you'll be disappointed because I'm not going to talk about that at all in the next 10 minutes. I'm talking about six basic patterns. Yeah? And I will have to rush through this, and apologies for that because I was 10 minutes back. Yeah. Cool. So, software world has been dominated in mythologies. If you didn't know that, currently, at this point in time, when we stand in 2015, there are about 28 or 29 practices actively being used across the world. Of course, there are some which are predominantly being used and some which are lesser used, but there are about 28 or 29 practices in the world. So if you think you're a Scrum guru and if you think you're a Kanban expert, sorry, you're just one of the 28 practices which are being used. Yet only 15%, and this is not my data, this data comes out from the Gartner report, by the way, which came out in 2012 or 2013, a really recent report, only 15% of those actually follow the methodology to the T. Rest, everybody adapts the methodologies. And we do need to adapt, because our products are very different, our people are very different, our geographies might be three different geographies. Right? This is what Mike Wolf said when he basically started using Scrum. This is a very, very old saying from Mike Wolf. He says, maybe an agile process sounds perfect for an organization, but you're wrong. It could be just a good starting point. He goes on to say, you will need to tailor it to fit your unique circumstances. This is not me saying it, this is not Emergent saying it, this is Mike Cohen saying it, whom a lot of you read about when you Google on Scrum. So, some examples of adaptations, right? So, the Agile Manifesto says interaction over documentation. But we work in a heavily regulated environment. People who are working for health industries, people who are looking for working for highly investment management companies, know how regulated those industries are. And if they are highly regulated, you will have to do something with your documentation. Healthcare produces a hell lot of documentation, and they have to. XP recommends design as you code, but our organization is so big. If you have a large, and this I think Scott Ambler, people would agree with me, because this Scott Ambler saying in a lot of large presentations when he does, is every large enterprise has to do some bit of early design. You can't get away with it. I was just doing a big data project in my last company, and there were about 250 databases to be migrated, about 6 terabytes of that. If I would start in the sprint right from day one without thinking how those 250 databases map to a new database model, I would be doomed, right? I can't say I'm agile, I don't need documentation, I'm XP. You need some bit of engineering, some engineering and design to be done. And then you have things like this, where Scrum demands small, preferably co-located teams. We are all part of cross-geography teams, I'm assuming, in this room. And we have proven that the cross-geography teams work. Yeah. These are some of the adaptations, just examples of it. There are zillions of more. So I guess the point which I'll make before I jump into the six patterns is you need to adapt. There's nothing wrong with adaptation. Just make sure you're not missing the fundamental principles. And for me, the fundamental principles are value, flow, and quality. You may call them differently. You may call them very differently in your organizations. You may treat them differently. But they're largely about these three categories. If you're managing these three areas well, I think you're agile enough. And under this umbrella, do whatever you want to do with Scrum. If Dean Leffingwell's release plan doesn't suit your need, don't use it. Don't run a two-day-long release planning meeting, guys. If you don't need it, you don't need it. You don't have to run it in that format. So lots of people ask, am I doing agile? And I think the answer is, it really depends upon the outcomes. It's not really about the label. It's less about whether I'm Scrum certified, I'm following Scrum or Kanban. It's really about the outcome, and the outcome is whether I'm delivering business value to my end client in a smaller amount of time, year after year or not. That's the only definition of success. It's the only definition of outcome in my head. So in the companies with great outcomes, we have noticed the six key patterns. First, a commitment to improve. And a commitment to improve is just not saying I'm using Scrum or I'm doing Kanban, right? A commitment to improve is, and it's also not, by the way, following best practices. Following best practices is another way of saying that I'm going to follow this book from this on, don't give me something else new. Because best practices don't evolve very quickly in organizations, I've seen. They get made and people keep following the best practices for months after months, years after years. your outcomes, your change initiatives need to be connected to outcomes. One thing which I'm right now doing in my second engagement with Tesco is first thing which I've told these guys is, guys, you've been trained now, you've been educated, which is good. Now, can you go back to your directors and ask them, what are the three things which we did in the next 3 months that will give you some results? And let's deliver those three things in 3 months. Because if we can't deliver the change to the outcome, the change will die. Second, and again, the commitment to improve requires actions. Second pattern is delivering early and often. We talked about as a principle, I'm talking about as a pattern also. So this is almost a mindset you need to start with, that I'm delivering early and often. If you're delivering in 18 months, start delivering in 6 months. If you're delivering in 6 months, start delivering in 1 month. People who are aware of the concept called cost of delay, the area between this graph and this graph, this, the solid line is where I've delivered early and often. The dotted line is where I've delivered in a slightly more waterfallish fashion. And the area which you have between these two is what we call as cost of delay. The appetite for the cost of delay for technology organizations today is very, 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 very low. People eat away market very quickly. If you have any one of the people in the person in this room is trying to build a product on their own, and if you have ever tried to build an iPhone app or an Android app, any idea which you come up with, no matter how novel it is, you will search for it, it's already there. And if it's not there, it'll be there tomorrow, I bet you. So if you delay by a day, you will have an iPhone app already there. So far, if I keep a backlog of the ideas I have come up on iPhone applications, I have at least 150 ideas in my backlog. I have never been able to put it out because I have never been fast enough to put it out soon enough. And by the time I'm ready, somebody else is already ready with it. So the appetite of the cost of delay, and cost of delay is a concept, a Kanban metric. I'll talk about it outside the room again with you guys if you want to know more about it, is what we need to be fairly focused on. We need to figure out a way to break down our large batch sizes into small ones and deliver them faster. Third key pattern is feedback. We talked about it, I'll not repeat it again. But basically, we need to figure out a way to build feedback loops and be open to that feedback. It is so essential to Agile. If you don't have a feedback loop, you're delivering crap to production faster. That's what you're doing, right? Because I'm iterative, I'm delivering everything to every 2 weeks to production, but I'm delivering crap to production every 2 weeks. And the feedback not in this manner, right? Even us as human beings individually, right, we say we are open to feedback. But when actually the appraisal round is run, right, and we are sitting in front of our bosses and the boss is giving us a feedback, this is how I feel, this is how we all of us feel. We are absolutely close to feedback. So that needs to change for us as individuals, and it needs to change for us as a team, and that needs to change for us as an organization. Fourth is self-organization. And this is the one which is the hardest one, by the way. Most captives in India have built their own silos or directors, right? Everybody had to grow. How will I grow in an organization? I will say, okay, no, you know what? I'm specialized in services. I'll become a services director. I'm specialized in web, I'll become a web director. I'm specialized in IT, I will build an IT director. And specialisms is one of the biggest killer of velocity, biggest killer of lead time. Because when the requirement will come, the four directors are gonna give their own buffered estimate that will get added up. It'll go to the person sitting somewhere else, he will add his own buffer on it, and ultimately what goes out to the market is a much longer number, just because we believe that we need specialisms. I don't disagree, there are some very, very specialized technology skills where specialism is needed. If I have big data, you can't expect big data expert to be available right away, hundreds of them in the market, they can go and pick and put it in a scrum team, it will not happen. So potentially you need a big data specialization potentially for some time. But the effort should be how to break that very quickly and make it mainstream. The sooner you can bring that popular technology mainstream, your success and the lead time is going to be low. I talk about it. The last pattern, or the second last pattern, is collaboration. Figure out your teams, talk. And talk not in the sense of a directorate meeting which happens once in a month. It's about teams collaborating. Some of the examples that I will pick, a test example because I have set it in the room. They built up in one of their cells, these guys build and build a functionality, and that functionality waits for getting tested by another organization, another group in the same company, in the same location, in the same building for about 2.5 months before those guys say, okay, no, yeah, now it's priority for us, let us test it now. And then they test it and then it goes to production. So the lead time is just, we have increased the 15 days work to 3 months because it was waiting on a shelf to get tested by another team in the same company. And the last pattern is, which I will close the session with, is treat code as an asset. One thing which I do in most of the organizations I work for, I make all of my developers sign a manifesto which is available there if you Google it. It's called Software Craftsmanship Manifesto. Which says that as a developer, I take pride in the work which I do. At the end of the day when I go home, it's not about my home loan and my car loan. It's about the work which I just did for 9 hours since the morning. I'm proud of it. And at the end of every month, I have a pin-up board in the all team areas where I ask people to put up what they are proud of. And if a team doesn't repeatedly have anything on that board, right, then it tells me something. People are doing the rounds and they're making money over the months. They're not really proud of anything what they're doing. And that is one thing which I think, again, if you did not take anything from the 6 patterns, if you just took this 6th pattern away, where code is actually treated as an asset in organizations, developer feels proud of what he has just developed, I think our situation will be much better 3 months, 4 months down the line. Make them sign the manifesto. It's not Scrum Alliance or it's not Kanban University which has put up the manifesto. There's a certain set of developers who came into being and they said, if I take pride in my work, these are the 5 things I'll agree to. And a lot of people have signed it. I think about more than a million. I signed it about 3 years back as well. And I make all of my developers sign it, make them sign that. And make them come back to you with something which they're proud of every 3 weeks or 4 weeks. And if they don't, yeah. Thank you guys. That's largely what I had.
Common principles we always talk about, but it's not like we just didn't.